Thanks for joining us for CBN NewsWatch. I'm Mark Martin. Well, if you waited until the last minute to file your taxes yesterday, you probably haven't recovered yet. America's tax code is a mess, and a lot of 2016 hopefuls want to do something about it. Dale Hurd has the story.
Tax filing deadline day means the annual political ritual of leaders from both parties calling for some sort of change in the tax code. But this year, with a crowded field of 2016 Republican presidential contenders, there are loud calls to liberate Americans and American business from the heavy burden of taxes. With the passing of April 15th, many Americans got their annual lesson in just how Byzantine and out of control America's tax code has become. Today, the tax code is over 74,000 pages and 187 times longer than a century ago, according to a study reported in the Washington Examiner. Most of the growth in the tax code has come in the past 30 years. Unsurprisingly, Republicans are talking about tax reform, like a flat tax rate of 17%. Republican candidate Marco Rubio is calling for a top rate of 35% for the wealthiest Americans, and 15% for those making less than $150,000 a year, while cutting the tax rate for businesses from 35 to 25%.
We have a tax code, for example, that has the highest combined corporate tax rate on the planet.
Republicans want to repeal the estate tax, something President Obama opposes. And the president was also pushing his own middle-class tax breaks in North Carolina this week.
The idea that in this country, we do best when everybody's getting a fair shot.
And the Republican leadership wants to rein in the IRS, too.
This week, we'll pass a series of bills to stop the IRS abuses and help hardworking taxpayers.
The Tax Foundation says if the tax code continues to grow at the same pace it did over the last century, it will pass 100,000 pages in 2050. Dale Hurd, CBN News.
A North Carolina pastor is speaking out about a tax scam that cost him more than $16,000 in hopes that it won't happen to any other church leaders. Reverend Al Cadenhead says he got a call last October from a person he thought was an IRS official. The scammer accused him of tax fraud, threatening to freeze his bank accounts and call the media. As part of the scam, Cadenhead was told to purchase prepaid Visa cards and transfer $16,500 on the phone. Cadenhead says he's telling about the incident so other church leaders don't fall victim to scammers. He says the IRS does not do business over the phone and that when calls are received, hang up. The Clinton Foundation has decided to limit foreign nations now that Hillary Clinton is running for president. Some critics were calling for a total ban on donations from foreign governments. The foundation had relied on funding from several Mideast governments that suppress and dissent, and women's rights. It will still accept millions of dollars from a select group of six U.S. allies. Hillary Clinton resigned as a board member of the foundation last week. A Florida postal worker delivered a message about campaign financing by landing a gyrocopter on the nation's Capitol lawn Wednesday, putting the place on lockdown for a few hours. The man, identified as Doug Hughes, flew and landed the small helicopter on the Capitol lawn undetected. Hughes had been planning the stunt for a while. Last year, he told his local paper about his plans to deliver letters to members of Congress demanding action on campaign finance.
I'm going to violate the no-fly zone.
You could have just mailed them.
You get hurt. And I'm going to land on the Capitol Mall in front of the Capitol building.
Honestly, I didn't think he would make it anywhere close to here. I see him coming over the top of the building. I was like, holy heavens, he's made it a long way.
The incident is raising concerns about security in the nation's capital. Evangelist Franklin Graham says he will hold prayer rallies in all 50 states next year. Graham announced the Decision American Tour on Facebook. He says he wants to encourage Christians to pray, boldly live out their faith, vote, and consider public office. Graham wrote, "I want to strongly urge Christians to run for public office at every level, local, state, and federal. We will not be endorsing any political candidates, but I will be proclaiming the truth of God's gospel in every state." One North Carolina county is putting "In God We Trust" on their county buildings. The commissioners of McDowell County voted unanimously for the move.
We just want to reaffirm
what our founding forefathers affirmed, that in God we trust. I think we're on pretty solid ground here with the court cases and courts, the ruling that the court has already given out.
Reactions are mixed, but there's a lot of public support for posting the national motto on the county buildings.
I love it. You can put it on any ever building in town if you'd like to, because that's who I trust is the Lord.
There's supposed to be a separation of church and state. I don't think it should be put on a public building.
The money for the In God We Trust signs will come from donations instead of taxpayers. Concerns about another Holocaust are indeed real in Israel today. 46% of Israelis believe a Holocaust could happen again, according to a survey by the Foundation for the Benefit of Holocaust Victims, reported by Haaretz. Nearly half of the survivors also think the Holocaust will be forgotten in the future. That survey coincides with Holocaust Remembrance Week, 70 years after the Allies opened the Nazi death camps and discovered 6 million Jewish people dead. Fewer than 100,000 survivors are alive today. But as John Waggy explains, Israelis are working hard to keep their memory alive.
It's difficult to grasp the horror and destruction of the Nazi killing machine. One-third of the world's Jews were murdered. The pain and scars endure to the next generations. David Hershkovitz would hear his mother screaming in her sleep as she relived the agony. A German soldier separated her from her own mother, who died at Auschwitz.
She didn't speak about the gas chambers because she wasn't there. She didn't speak about the fact that they were burning bodies. She wasn't there. But during the separation, she was there, and the separation didn't leave her.
Hershkovitz's mother died 2 years ago, but through a second-generation study course in Central Israel, he's keeping her story alive. The Shem Olam Holocaust Institute is educating people like Hershkovitz to tell their stories when the Holocaust survivors are gone. The Institute's director, Avram Krieger, says many children didn't ask tough questions of their parents.
How did the parents deal with guilt questions during those moments? How did they go through the difficult moments of separation, of leaving, of difficult decisions? They weren't able to ask this, and apparently, the parents weren't able to answer.
Meanwhile, in Jerusalem, the Yad Vashem Holocaust Museum tells more stories in an exhibition called Children in the Holocaust, Stars Without a Heaven, with dolls and sketches. Ina Renat Rahavi's teddy bear is on display. She carried the bear during a remarkable escape with her mother from the train car leading them to Auschwitz.
Teddy lasted better than I did, and many others. He is more war wounded than I am, since he is missing an ear and an arm. But he was a real hero.
John Waggy, CBN News.
In other news, the former head of Salem Communications and the National Religious Broadcasters will now lead James Kennedy Ministries. Dr. Frank Wright recently served as president of Salem, a Christian radio broadcaster and internet content provider. He also spent 10 years leading the National Religious Broadcasters. The Florida-based James Kennedy Ministries produces nationally syndicated TV and radio broadcasts. Wright was a longtime friend of the late James Kennedy.
She said, "There's only so much room in my heart, so I don't hate. To hate is to let Hitler win."
Coming up, they survived the Holocaust and they want the whole world to know. Hear how they're sharing their stories in new ways. Today is Holocaust Remembrance Day, 70 years since the liberation of the Nazi concentration camps. The number of Holocaust survivors is dwindling, but a new technology is keeping their stories alive for the next generation. Paul Strand has the story.
Sisters Rena and Danka Kornreich survived almost all of World War II together in Nazi death camps. In fact, Rena was on the first trainload of women sent to Auschwitz, fooled into thinking it was just a short-term work camp.
297 teenagers are on the first transport. 50 are dead in the first 6 months.
Rena's Promise documents how the sisters kept each other alive and helped many others. A key part of their survival, refusing to dwell on the reality of the daily gassings and killings going on all around them.
She does see the SS pour the Zyklon B into the gas chamber, and she's on a work detail where she can see that. She never goes on that work detail again. She can't, she realizes that to see that is her spirit to die.
Rena rose above it all after the war by putting Hitler and the Nazis behind her. She wholeheartedly embraced life and gave it, like to her only daughter, Sylvia.
Apparently, when I was born, my mother was just elated. And, you know, we've heard stories that she, you know, felt like this is the revenge on Hitler.
The Nazis did at one point steal Rena's faith as she watched them march hundreds of little orphans into the gas chambers.
About 500 children, and they're holding teddy bears, and she prays.
As she begged God to stop the horror, a Nazi guard got right into her face.
SS Hasse came up to her, spit in her face, and said, "Where is your God now?" And that's the moment when Rena lost her faith in God.
She also witnessed the Nazis kill off beautiful Jewish women, including her friend Adela Gross.
They selected 2,000 healthy, young, beautiful women for the gas. Adela was healthy. She's redhead, gorgeous young woman. And Rena watched her go to the gas.
It took decades, but Rena regained her faith as she saw thousands inspired by her book.
And how the story is helping them to believe in survival, to believe in love, to believe in the strength of the human spirit. And she said, "There's only so much room in my heart, so I don't hate, I love. To hate is to let Hitler win."
Rena and Donka ended up in America and remained close for some 50 years before Rena passed away in 2006. Donka died 6 years later, but their story is now chronicled forever.
When you hear 6 million Jews and 10 million people total, that's such a phenomenal figure that it's very hard to put that into the reality of what happened there. And by having all the individuals that we can now tell stories about, including my mother and my aunt, that makes it real.
These stories and those of other survivors keep this tragic part of history alive in the hope that it will never be repeated. New generations can better learn about the Holocaust through a new app produced by these men called Sacred Ground. Recording studio owner John Keel says the app transports users to Berlin's Holocaust Memorial.
And there are these little stones that you start walking through, and they get bigger and bigger and bigger until you're walking through these tunnels. And the message being is that this is how this kind of evil overtakes us. It grows until we're trapped.
We've all seen those horrifying images from the Holocaust, the skin and bones bodies stacked high like cordwood. What's important to remember is that each one of those bodies represents a life lived fully and richly before the Holocaust.
It needs to be about the lives that they led and remembering that they were just like me and just like you until someone declared that they were not. And it's not a declaration that can be made.
You can also hear Baltimore Rabbi Moshe Dov Shawali talk about his own family's horror.
My name Moshe Dov is after my mother's dad, Moshe, who was murdered in the Ukraine in front of her when she was 16 and he was 46.
He said the Holocaust, or Shoah, made him feel like a victim, and he wanted to rise above that by rituals that would consecrate the millions of lives snuffed out. Cantor Emmanuel Perlman hopes the ritual prayers and music he and his co-producers put on this app will allow millions to memorialize those survivors and victims on every Holocaust Remembrance Day.
There had never, ever been, to my knowledge, any special prayers that were composed, written for the Holocaust.
Perlman grabbed up his first grandchild, Abner Judah, to point out how he hopes this app will serve the future.
He'll be able to understand history in the way in which we see history from generation to generation.
Then this proud new grandpa just rejoiced at this bundle of joy in his arms. It is important to remember the Holocaust, but also to have an antidote to it. Living fully, giving life, and celebrating all it has to offer. Paul Strand, CBN News, reporting from Baltimore.
Up next, ISIS has spawned wannabe terrorists around the world, and they're starting by targeting Christians. One former hostage tells us why he was released. The terror group ISIS has inspired extremists to commit their own atrocities in other parts of the world, including Southeast Asia. Radical Islamists there have carried out attacks against Christians. Gary Lane brings us this CBN News exclusive report from the Philippines.
After Islamic State fighters routed the Iraqi army last summer, the world realized the growing threat of ISIS. Its terror spread from Syria and Iraq to Libya and other parts of Africa, where Nigeria's Boko Haram recently pledged its allegiance. Add to this reports of operations in Pakistan and Afghanistan, and now the ISIS influence is reaching as far away as Southeast Asia. Islamic extremists want to control this area of the southern Philippines, and even though ISIS has yet to accept them into their organization, the MILF and the Islamic State have shared ideology. That includes destroying churches, kidnapping and killing Christians. Just ask missionary Pastor Daniel. He asked that we hide his face to protect him from further persecution. Last fall, Daniel and two other family members were kidnapped by a splinter group of the Moro Islamic Liberation Front, or MILF.
When the two men captured me, I had a towel around my neck. One of the Muslim soldiers grabbed the towel and told me, "We will use this to wipe the blood from your neck."
They took Daniel to their camp, where he met a notorious Islamic terrorist known as Commander Tuckboy. Tuckboy said he would behead the evangelist for leading tribal people to Christ.
I told him, "I was only helping the tribes. There is nothing wrong with preaching the gospel while serving them." He said, "Anyone who brings the gospel of Jesus Christ and upholds the God of Israel is our enemy." I noticed his soldiers digging a hole in front of me. I heard one ask, "Do you think he will fit in this?" So I knew the grave was for me. This was it. This was my time for death.
And Pastor Daniel says Commander Tuckboy revealed his true identity.
Tuckboy asked, "Do you know me? I'm the leader of ISIS in the Mindanao Islands. The Philippine government has been hunting me for a long time." Then he showed me the ISIS flag hanging in the camp. I also saw documents that had an ISIS flag on the letterhead.
Daniel's family and friends prayed as the ordeal continued. Daniel's 10-year-old daughter, Carol, was among them. She tearfully told us she trusted God to deliver her father from death.
We prayed John 15:7 for Papa. "If you remain in me and my words in you, ask whatever you want and it will be done for you."
The next morning, Commander Tuckboy received an urgent phone call.
Tuckboy handed me the cell phone. A big voice on the other end asked, "Are you Pastor Daniel?" I said, "Yes." He said, "Do you know today is the date of your death?" I replied, "Yes. If Jesus Christ wills it, today is my day." Then he said, "You are lucky. We are sparing your life. You are not going to die today."
Daniel returned home with a warning. Stop evangelizing tribal people. Daniel now lives in another part of Mindanao. Foreign Ministry spokesman Charles Jose says the kidnapping does not mean ISIS is gaining a foothold in southern Philippines.
We're not exactly convinced that they're really ISIS. Maybe they're just jumping on the bandwagon. Most of them are, you know, engaged in banditry and kidnap for ransom activities.
However, the Philippine government is investigating reports that potential ISIS recruits have received training in a remote village not far from Zamboanga City. Despite his near-death experience and the possibility that he could be kidnapped again, Daniel continues to share the gospel with the tribal people of Mindanao.
"The incident taught me not to fear death. I saw the power of God. Jesus delivered me out of death, and it has made me bolder to serve God because I saw his power."
And Carol knows why she has her papa back.
"We did not know where to find Papa, but God knew where to find him. The Lord brought him out of the camp. The Lord answered our prayers. God is so good to our family."
Gary Lane, CBN News, Mindanao, Philippines.
It's been nearly a week since a deadly tornado ripped through a small northern Illinois farming community. Residents are allowed back into the area to assess damage and salvage what they can. Operation Blessing is on the ground, helping with cleanup and debris removal. Teams are also ministering to spiritual needs with the love of Christ. Charlene Aaron has the story.
Residents in northern Illinois returned to their devastated communities this week to pick up the pieces after a massive tornado tore through the region. The deadly EF tornado unleashed winds reaching 200 miles an hour, leaving behind a 50-mile trail of destruction, homes and businesses destroyed in its path. Operation Blessing arrived within hours after the storm struck. Partnering with longtime ministry partner and strike team, Rockford First Assembly of God. Since the tornado ripped through agricultural areas, Operation Blessing helped farmers by clearing their fields so they can still plant and harvest.
Operation Blessing comes in, and in a short time they're in piles, and people are taking the piles up and stacking it away so that I can finally farm again.
More than 1,300 volunteers joined up with Operation Blessing to help victims in the city of Rochelle, where they've been clearing debris, cutting down damaged trees, and moving piles of brush.
As you can see, 360 degrees just in this one neighborhood. It's only a small area out of the 50-mile tornado path that was hit. 360 degrees, there's total devastation, homes without roofs, brick walls collapsed, windows out, trees stripped bare of their bark and their limbs and their branches. But we're in the Midwest, so not only do we have loving hearts here to help, we have a lot of heavy equipment. This made a huge difference here in this community.
Jim Shaebacker's farm was hit hard by the tornado. He says he's grateful for the love and support of Operation Blessing volunteers.
The Operation Blessing volunteers did wonderful work. They gleaned our fields. I mean, without them, I don't know how we'd ever get it done.
Operation Blessing says its goal is to share the love of Christ in a very tangible way while helping families who have lost so much.
In the beginning of the day, I noticed that some of the residents that we were helping had a demeanor that lacked hope, and that by the end of the day I saw smiles, and I saw that while people were talking at the end of the day, there was a difference, that the yard that they had when they went to sleep was different than the yard that they had when they woke up. What was an overwhelming problem in the morning was something that was solved, not completely, but at least in a huge way by the end of the day.
Charlene Aaron, CBN News.
Great to see that ministry there. Well, that's it for now on CBN NewsWatch, and you can find more of our exclusive coverage of the issues you care most about at cbnnews.com. Tell us what you think about the stories you've seen here, and you can do that on Facebook or at CBN News on Twitter. Hope you'll join us next time. Have a great day.